This week on The Gadget Show.
We embrace winter and use it and all its nastiness to test rugged watches, personal media players, and some dead fun snow transport gadgets. Whoa!
And Jon gains access to the R&D departments of some of Britain's leading tech companies and gives us a peek into the future of gadgetry.
Hello and welcome to The Gadget Show.
This week, as we edge towards the very depths of winter, you could be forgiven for getting a little bit depressed. I mean, it's cold outside, it's dark most of the... It's cold inside, all right? Most of my extremities are a lot smaller. I mean, they're small, normally, don't get me wrong. But they're even, these ears are normally twice this size, OK? Winter has a way of making everyone antisocial and smaller, all right? Think about it. And don't even get me started on carol singers.
But we've decided that winter should be celebrated. We should embrace it. So this week, we've used it to test a whole range of gadgets.
That's right, but we began by torturing watches.
We've got two of the toughest watches around, and we'll see which one stands up best to the general abuse of everyday life and beyond.
So we've devised a few rather chilling and nasty wintry tests for them to see which can take the most punishment.
I have gone for this G-Shock Golfman, and it comes with a great pedigree.
Each watch is shaken, dropped and smacked about to make sure they are worthy of being one of the world's toughest watches. This Golfman is their latest and toughest. Its titanium case is stuffed full of internal rubber cushioning to keep the mechanism safe.
I want a watch that comes in a box like this, eh? And is used by Navy SEALs. The MTM Extreme Op Silver Seals fluid-filled case is made from a solid block of stainless steel. This watch can't be compressed at all by water pressure, the face is made from one of the toughest substances on Earth, and the carbon fibre dial is from NASA.
To test our watch's scratch resistance, we secured them to these mannequin hands and left them to face the might of the road gritter.
You all right, Suzi? You want a hand? With the watches safely secured, it was time to blast them. Go for it, Andy!
6 cubic metres of rock salt was shot from the gritter at speeds of around 70 miles an hour. My G-Shock has a raised bezel around the outside to protect the face and buttons from direct impact, and the resin body is naturally scratch-resistant.
My Extreme Silver Seal watch face uses a hardened sapphire crystal, one of the most scratch-resistant substances on Earth.
So, did our watches survive the onslaught unscathed?
Oh, my, look at that.
Mine's looking quite good. It's not scratched at all, look.
Let me have a look at mine, then.
It's looking good as well, isn't it?
Suzi, that is looking... God, it is looking good.
They were more than a match for the gritter, so we had to get really nasty with a temperature test.
We attached our watches to fishing rods and sank them into a vat of ice that had been chilling at minus 20 for a couple of days.
Low temperatures cause the internal workings of a gadget to contract and pull apart, breaking vital connections.
But my G-Shock watch will stay ticking down to a chilly minus 20.
My Extreme Ops is filled with a special silicon fluid, except for one air bubble, which takes the full force of any contraction through temperature.
So, how did the watches fare in this super chilled water? Absolutely fine. They were cold, but working perfectly. If we wanted to hurt them, we had to get really brutal.
The final test is to see just how our watches handle shock and impact. We joined Coventry Blaze ice hockey team for a game of five-a-side hockey using the watches as pucks.
Oh, oh, oh yeah!
No messing about. We went straight into the game with a face-off. We played half the time with one watch, half with the other.
These guys can hit a puck or our watches up to speeds of 100 miles an hour.
The G-Shock protects the digital workings, the battery and the LCD with a titanium case and shockproof rubber ring that surrounds the workings. Wait for me!
My Extreme Ops doesn't have any particularly fancy protection system. It's just built hardcore.
Okay, woo!
But on the ice, my MTM slowly succumbed as bit by bit the strap broke apart.
My G-Shock, on the other hand, was absolutely fine.
Oh, fine!
Until the guys took it upon themselves to get really rough.
A couple of full-power slap shots later, it was all over.
It's broken!
Oh! those boys. They were like dogs on a leash, weren't they, from the beginning? They wanted to whack those watches to within each of their lives.
They hit them so hard, didn't they? Yeah. I mean, neither of these watches claimed to withstand that sort of torture, but they both did so well right up until the end.
They did, and I think, though, that, you know, as challenges go on the Gadget Show, this was a fair challenge because, you know, a watch, you'll wear it for 10 years and you'll drop it, it'll form a tarmac when you get into the car, you know, or you play sports and it gets slammed. Maybe not quite that quickly within
maybe
an
not
hour.
Maybe 100 miles an hour.
Yeah, but over the 10-year life of a watch, whatever it is, I think it's a fair assessment.
The fact is that both of these watches are incredibly rugged, but which one should you go for?
Yeah, I mean, if you've got a chunk of money to spend, then I'd always go for this. That's a classic gentleman adventurer's wristwatch.
Yeah, but if you haven't got a huge budget, I mean, this is a tenth of the price of that, and you want a good, rugged adventure watch, go for the G-Shock.
Time for a little break now, but after that, we find out what are the best long-life batteries on the market.
And Jon takes a peek into our gadget future, going behind the scenes at the R&D facilities of some of Britain's leading tech companies.
Welcome back. Now, we want to talk to you about our Broadband Truth campaign. We launched the campaign to try and make Britain's internet service providers be a little bit more straight with us, the customers, about the broadband speeds that we're actually getting.
They sell broadband packages quoting the speed you'll get as an up to figure, up to 2 meg, up to 8 meg and so on. The trouble is our research shows that many people aren't getting anything like this top of the line up to figure most of the time.
That's right, most of the studies that we've seen suggest that less than half of broadband users ever get to that maximum figure. And you know, the responses that we've been getting from you at home suggest that you're not happy about that. In fact, some of you feel deceived.
Yeah, now a few weeks ago we did ask the 5 leading ISPs in the UK when they were going to do what their customers obviously wanted them to do and find a much more honest way of expressing the speeds that they're actually selling.
That's right, some of you have been emailing in with various suggestions, one of which would be at least. Okay, so, you know, that would be a fair reflection of the slowest speeds, but obviously it's not going to look very good on a billboard.
And another option is actually to show the range of speeds you'll experience, something like between 1 and 8 megabits. But again, that level of transparency and honesty may not prove that effective when you're trying to attract customers.
But the bottom line is, at the moment, the ISPs are happy to stick their fingers in their ears and ignore us and continue using that term up to.
Or are they? The good news is we've had a very significant breakthrough. One internet service provider, Fast for Internet, has been in touch as a direct result of our campaign and pledged to change the wording both in its sales pitches and on its website. It's going to drop the use of the dreaded up to term altogether.
I went to meet the company director, Steve Kay.
What are you going to do?
We're going to back your campaign. When a customer comes to our site, the same as any other site, puts in their telephone number as a checker to see if they can actually obtain broadband, we get back in raw data from BT, from their own database, two figures, a worst figure and a best figure. And that could be, let's say, 3 to 5 meg. That's the two figures that we'll be able to provide in between, rather than up to 8 meg.
So you're going to go for between rather than up to?
Yes, we are. Yeah.
Excellent. I mean, is there any reason why other ISPs can't do this?
Technically, they all get the same data from BT. When they all do the line check, they can analyse the data in which way they want and change their products if they wanted to.
OK, so they're not the biggest internet service provider in the world, but it is a great start. We've still got a long way to go, though, and if we're going to convince the leading ISPs to drop the awful up to term, we're going to have to keep piling on the pressure.
And piling on that pressure really is having an effect. One of Britain's leading ISPs has even contacted us to complain about the number of complaints they're getting from their broadband customers. So don't be shy about making yourself heard.
Before you do, make sure you've got a really good range of readings from speed tests. Remember, they're just an indicator of speed.
So to get a reasonable average, you're going to need to do at least 20 tests at different times of the day, and from a number of different speed checkers, not just ours. There are links to other speed checkers on our website.
You're then in a position to make a formal complaint in writing. Your ISP will tell you who to address this to. And if they're blaming a third party, say BT, for the quality of the phone line, then send them a copy too. Remember, the contract's between you and your ISP, not BT. If there's a problem at the exchange, it's the ISP's job to resolve that with BT, not yours.
If you've gone as far as you can with your ISP and you're still not happy, you could then contact the Internet Service Providers Association. They're the trade body for ISPs, and it's their job to mediate disputes. As a last resort, you could take your ISP to a small claims court. You'll need to keep speed test results and any correspondence as evidence, and you should seek legal advice to check your case is a good one.
But of course, writing to your ISP if you're unhappy should be enough, and we now really believe that if plenty of us do that, we'll get rid of up to forever.
Here's a great idea that means you can actually make some money out of your online video clips. It's called Blinks.com and a feature they refer to as ad hoc. It's a very simple point and click affair. All you do is put your details of your video into the Blinks website and they add advertising to it. So you end up with your clip on your blog or whatever it be, in your Facebook, and you could earn up to hundreds of pounds for a popular video.
Now I'd like to share with you the results of some very important testing that we've been doing. We have been testing batteries to see which ones you should be buying this Christmas to power the sack loads of gadgets and toys that will be arriving at your house bearing those three very irritating words, batteries not included. So which brand actually lasts the longest and which make is the best value for money? We'll show you right now.
Here we have a lot of batteries. I'll tell you what they're all called, but it would just waste time. Why don't you have a look at them and see if there are any you recognise? Then we can move on. We've got name brands, we've got no name, and we've got supermarkets own. We've got lithium batteries, alkaline batteries, long life, premium, ultra and power. For a full list, check out our website.
To him, you, me, or anybody really, they're all just words. The only things that matter about batteries are how much they cost and how long they last for. And that is what we're here to find out. We've got 18 of these barking, yapping dogs. Each of them will have a different set of batteries in. We'll set them all going at the same time and see which lasts the longest. Simple.
Then at the end of it all, we'll work out some kind of mathematical chart that will show you what the best value battery you can buy is. In other words, which one lasts longest for each penny it costs.
OK, now we all must switch the buttons at exactly the same time. We'll do it on the word go after the count of three.
Okay.
OK? So here we go. Three, two, one, go!
Most of the batteries here are alkaline-based. Initially developed in the 1950s, chemicals inside react when the battery is turned on, releasing electrons and creating an electrical charge.
In a power-hungry digital camera, for example, an alkaline battery, the capacity can drop as much as 75%.
Much more suited to high-intensity loads like digital cameras and sat-navs, though, are lithium batteries like these.
Lithium batteries have only been around for about 2.5 years, and the chemicals inside are the most powerful substances that can be put into a battery at the moment. At £7, though, they're the most expensive batteries here. But will they go the distance to justify the price tag? Oh! This one's dead! Some that definitely didn't are the Wilkinson Power Plus. In our test, the two batteries in the dog lasted a feeble 34 minutes and 19 seconds. It's OK, so he's out. Is this what it's like having kids?
Yeah.
This noise is driving me mad. With the testing going on all around us, with that constant yapping and 17 dogs left to go, I found myself wishing it was colder.
Cold temperatures severely inhibit the chemical reaction inside batteries, dramatically reducing their life. There was no such luck, though. We were in a nice room temperature room, the ideal scenario to get the most out of your batteries. It took a much more respectable 1 hour, 57 minutes and 27 seconds for the next set of batteries to die. Stop! Halfords! Halfords are stopped!
I'm going mad down here. Jason's allergic to dogs. He's gone off to get a cup of tea. Three, two, one. Left alone, I started to lose the plot a little. Three, two, one. Woohoo! Three. Luckily, action was on its way. Just after the 2 hour mark, a load of batteries started to give up the ghost. 2 hours, 4 minutes, 10 seconds for Panasonic. 2 hours, 9 minutes, and 27 seconds. 2 hours, 10 minutes, and 4 seconds. We've got another loser here, Early Learning Centre. 2 hours, 11 minutes and 27 seconds. Another one bites the dust and he's off to doggy heaven. Hello, boys. Hello.
Jason came back with the tea in the nick of time.
Oh, you
sorry, I had to get these. It was really important.
What? This is important. Our dog's just died.
Time of death?
2 hours, 32 minutes and 11 seconds. Oh. And you were out getting tea.
Sorry, I'm sorry, Maplins.
Who is it? So 2¾ hours we've been going now. There's 7 dogs remaining. What's interesting is we've got Boots still here, but Morrison's still going with Boots. In the big brand batteries,
well,
what
you've
we got
Duracell Energizer and you've got Kodak.
Yeah.
OK. Jessop's and Sony. So, you know, big names.
Yeah.
You'd certainly think that the Sonys, the Energizers and the Duracells of this world would be in the race at this point, but not Morrison's.
I think it's fair to say that Morrison's is the underdog.
In the end, it was down to an elite club of three who'd broken the 3-hour mark. The Energizer Lithiums, Kodak and, impressively, the supermarket Morrison's.
But it all came quickly to an end after 3 hours, 3 minutes and 2 seconds when the Morrison's dog was no more. And just over half an hour later, Kodak died, leaving just the Energizer as the winner to go on and on and on.
And incredibly, the Energizer lithium batteries went on for 6 hours, 57 minutes and 48 seconds of yapping and flipping.
Oh, of madness-inducing yapping and flipping. So the Energizer lithium lasted the longest, but in our test, it didn't represent the best value for money because it cost 50p per hour to run. Now, we did the same value for money test on all of the batteries in our dogs, and we found that the best overall was this, the Morrison's battery, which only cost us 29p per hour to run our little dog.
Which is incredible, because that's almost half the price of these, isn't
amazing.
It? And on that bombshell, it is now time for the focus group. Each week in the focus group, John, Jason and I present the best gadget we can find in a particular category to our focus group, and they tell us which one they think is the best. This week, we're looking ahead to a time after Christmas where we've eaten too much and drunk too much and want to lose some weight. So this week, it's fitness gadgets. We've come to Virgin Active in Birmingham, and our focus group is made up, as you can see, of super trim fitness instructors. But to go first, our very own Body Beautiful, the gadget show's own, Jon Bentley.
We're not allowed to broadcast blatant lies, Susie. Now, whenever I go out exercising, doing a walk or a run or something, I never know what to do with my arms. I feel as though my legs are getting plenty of exercise, but not my arms. However, this German system called the SMOVI could well be the answer. It's ball bearings in tubes, and they sort of form a natural resistance and give your arms a bit of a, what I suppose would be called a workout. Now, you look pretty fit sort of chap and understand exercise. I just wondered if you'd have a go with them, see what you think.
Well, you know, you could take them to a nightclub. You get that well there.
Do you feel as though they're doing you any good?
Not really, no.
No, I don't see the point of them. You could just use dumbbells.
I find it quite an annoying noise. I think you'd have to put your iPod on if you were running with them.
Oh dear, I don't seem to be getting anywhere with my SMOVIs. Jason, you're on.
Hi, gang. Did you see the way I leapt to say hello there? That's because I'm wearing Vibram Five Fingers, a new shoe designed to enable you to do your workout or do your running or your yoga or whatever as if you're in bare feet. Isn't that a bizarre shoe? As you can see, all of my toes go right into these little toe socket thingies. The concept of these shoes is to give you more balance, okay? To lower blood pressure, apparently, when you're doing things like running and cardiovascular work. And also, it's good if you suffer from back pain because it enables you to spread the balance out.
I think because of the way your feet are, there's possibly going to be a difference in stability. It might improve that, but I don't think there's enough support or cushioning on the joints, really, with these shoes on to actually run in them.
Right, ladies and gents, Rocky for the 21st century. This is Jump Snap. It's the first ropeless jump rope. Have a little look. It's computerised, so you put your height and your weight in here and then you start working out. It was invented actually by a guy that was overweight and he kept on tripping over the rope and he felt too embarrassed to go to the gym. So this is really for people that are working out at home that are trying to, you know, lose a bit of weight before they start going to the gym, if you like. So obviously jumping up and down, you're going to start to burn calories.
Obviously.
Any benefit do you feel with that?
No, not really.
Tell me, if that is the same as skipping with the rope, do you feel as though you're getting the same benefit?
I think it's the same motion.
Yep.
But I don't think I'm getting the same benefit. But with this, I just feel quite silly.
Having shown off our gadgets, we then let our trim and tone focus group spend a little time trying them out for themselves so they could decide which they liked best.
That's 15 calories.
Okay, so you've seen all three of our fitness gadgets, but now it's time to vote with your hands. You can only choose one, all right? So if you'd like to get fit with John and his Smovies, raise them high.
Oh!
You were right. It's unanimous. Not at all. Okay, what about the Vibram Five Fingers? If you'd like to put these on your feet, put your hands in the air. Oh!
Well, that's pretty unanimous.
Wow.
No, but we haven't finished yet.
Could be some weird warp in the mathematics continuum, and you might win. With Susie's ropeless skipping rope, anybody? Hands up. Well, we have a winner, I'm proud to say, on behalf of myself. It's the Vibram Five Fingers!
Yay!
Sorry.
Right, time for another break now, but after that...
Our winter challenge gets colder as Jason and I get trapped in our cars in a great big snowdrift, all to test the iPod Touch.
And John gets an exclusive look at some of the most exciting gadgetry being developed in the secret R&D facilities of Britain's tech companies.
Welcome back. Now it's time to return to our winter challenge. In the first part, we put a couple of rugged watches through their paces and, well, to be quite honest, we broke them into lots of little pieces.
But for the next stage of our challenge, we decided to put this little beauty through its paces, the iPod Touch. It's Apple's first true multimedia player, available with either 8 or 16 gig of memory. It packs Wi-Fi connectivity and is designed to handle video just as easily and conveniently as iPods have always handled music.
While the iPod Touch may have the name and the style, but is it actually as good as the latest offering from the inventors of multimedia players, Arcos? This is the Arcos 605 Wi-Fi. It wirelessly surfs the web, it plays half a dozen audio and video formats, it displays photos and PDFs, and it can even operate as a PVR and record television programmes.
To test these two rivals against each other, Susie and I were set a rather bizarre wintry challenge involving two cars, several tons of snow and some rather warm clothing.
Winter's a treacherous time to be in a car. When it snows in this country, people get stranded.
The AA advised taking blankets and a torch in case you get stuck. We advise taking a PMP.
Right. Oh, God! I don't like this.
To find the best PMP for the job, we were buried in the Tamworth Snow Dome in a couple of little Kias.
All right. Yeah, thanks. I get the point. It's actually quite claustrophobic in here. I feel, you know, hemmed in, to put it mildly.
To get rescued from the snowdrift, we had to use our device's features to complete three challenges. The first of which was to access the Gadget Show website, where a message would give us further instructions.
Once we were firmly encased in our icy tombs, it was time for the race to start.
I'm going to go straight into Safari, because that's part of my challenge. Safari is, of course, the browser native to the whole Mac family.
Whenever you need to type in a web address on the iPod's touchscreen, a QWERTY keyboard pops up.
I particularly like the keyboard when it's in... Let me just try this. When it's in the horizontal format, that's the accelerometer built into the device that enables me to just turn it, and then it gives me that landscape device intuitively. This is much better than in vertical format because your thumbs can get around there.
The browsing experience with the Arcos was equally smooth.
The built-in Wi-Fi uses the open source web browser Opera, and it's been optimized for this smaller screen.
Like the iPod, whenever you need to type, a QWERTY keyboard pops up. The good thing is the keys are quite well spaced.
So if you have got quite chunky fingers, this would still work for you. I'm not saying I've got chunky fingers, by the way.
Unfortunately, web browsing isn't standard. It costs about £15 to download a plugin, but it's totally worth it because it also gives you access to a whole load of downloadable content.
I'm on the website, and I've got to go into Winter Special.
We were neck and neck as we searched for the next clue on the Gadget Show website.
Right, there's the clue.
Ah, Winter Challenge number two. Winter Challenge number two, that's what it says on the website. I've got to find a track called that. All right, brilliant.
We both found the clue at pretty much the same time. Now we had to play a music track, something my iPod was born for.
The music functionality of the iPod Touch is obviously one of its biggest selling points. I just love the way it's been implemented. You know, you get these lovely big images of albums that you can scroll through. You click it, you look at the different tracks, you get information about the track itself. You can use Wi-Fi to download music direct to the device. That's one of the coolest functions
of this machine. I just love it. I've got a music. There's Winter Challenge. There it is.
Winter Challenge number two. There it is. Let's click on that. Here we go. Nice winter song for the Winter Challenge.
As a music player, the Arcos fares pretty well. It's small enough to carry anywhere, and it can play back MP3s, protected Windows media files, and WAVs, amongst others. Where it really excels, though, is in its storage space. You can get a 160-gig version. The maximum iPod Touch only goes up to 16 gigs.
Now you must view a video called Winter Challenge number 3. It contains the key to your escape.
The message from Jon, hidden at the end of the song, told us to find a video preloaded onto our players.
That's Jon. Winter Challenge number 3 is a video.
This was now a race against time. Whichever device made it easiest to find and play the video would come out on top.
So we need to get out of music and go to video.
The 3.5-inch screen on the Touch makes watching videos a worthwhile experience, and finding them is a matter of two taps. And you can watch them for up to 5 hours on a single charge. The only thing I would say about the iPod Touch is I can't seem to find an external volume control. I'm pretty sure it doesn't have one. The iPhone does, this device doesn't, and it means I've got to go into the main screen in order to change the volume, which is not great, really.
Using either the touchscreen or the menu buttons on the side, accessing videos is really easy. And Arcos claim their LCD's resolution is the highest quality in any PMP.
Quality of the screen, the picture, I think is excellent.
I easily found the video on my player.
There it is, look, so I'm just going to click on, double click on that.
Congratulations, freedom is yours.
Woohoo! What?
The message in the video told us to lean over and get a walkie-talkie from the boot. We'd been neck and neck, but my celebration meant I'd missed the instructions.
Suzi playing it again was all I needed to take the lead. All right, that's the information I need. I've got to get to the boot, excuse me.
In the boot is a walkie-talkie, call them in and they'll set me free.
Oh, yes. Straight in there. I grabbed the walkie-talkie from the boot and radioed outside to be released.
Put a rubber ducky on your tail. What am I supposed to say? It's Jace, let me out. Hey, they're here. The rescue team are here. Good work, boys. Hurry up. I haven't got all day. Get on with it.
The iPod Touch had won. I was free. Ah.
Yay! Woo!
It's Suzi, get me out, get me out.
I just had to wait for Suzi to be freed so I could rub it in.
Oi!
No!
It's me!
No!
That means I won!
No!
That means I won! Brilliant!
No! Yay! So I think the iPod Touch won that challenge, Suze.
I think it's fair that the iPod Touch did kick the Arcos into touch, literally. I still like the big screen on this, but in terms of style,
yeah.
I think it has to go to the iPod
Touch. From a star point of view, but also it was a lot quicker with the web browsing, wasn't it? And
yeah.
Generally, the ease of use for finding content on this, video, music and so on, I think gave it the win.
So in our winter challenge, Jason just edges into the lead. But still to come, our grand finale, packed full of some of the most incredible snow transport gadgets on the market. It really is great fun. Don't miss that one.
Now, I want to talk to you about your future, your gadget future, the sorts of gadget we might all be using in a few years' time. I've just been on a short road trip round some of the UK's top research and development facilities. This is what they're up to.
The first stop on my journey was BT's research and development facilities in Ipswich. It was their recent work in motion sensing technology that I was interested in.
Now, we're used to seeing motion sensors and accelerometers in all sorts of things these days, everything from the Nintendo Wii's Wiimotes to your mobile phone, where they're used to tell which way up it is. Now, BT are trying to use the same technology to simplify the process of operating a laptop.
This is a prototype of BT Balance, a USB device that's packed with motion and balance sensors. It allows you to control any tablet, PC or laptop by simply moving it around.
I can go through the menu by tilting it from side to side like that, until I get to the one I want, and then when I got the application, I enter it by tilting the laptop forward. This one's a book, actually a very interesting copy of the BT annual report.
and I can flip through the document by tilting the laptop about its central axis. And when I'm done with that, I can shake it like an Etch-a-Sketch to get back to the main menu.
Currently, Balance only supports a handful of custom-made applications, but it looks to me like one day, using your laptop could be literally as easy as flicking through a book. Touchscreens are another interface we're seeing more and more of. But at Visual Planet in Cambridge, I came across a brand new touchscreen technology, unlike anything I'd ever seen before.
If you want a touchscreen that's absolutely enormous and virtually indestructible, you need one of these, a VIP interactive foil.
Now, it might look like a sheet of plastic, but the VIP interactive foil has the power to turn any, and I mean any, non-metallic surface into a fully functional touchscreen.
In this case, I've got a sheet of glass on which we're projecting the display from a computer. The foil's mounted on the back of the glass, and when you touch the front of the glass, your finger disturbs an energy field that's generated by a circuit in the foil.
It's called projected capacitance technology, and the field's produced by tiny wires threaded through the plastic. What's clever is that the field radiates out from the wires and through whatever the foil's stuck to. It easily penetrates a glass sheet.
This glass is 10 millimeters thick, but the effect works if the glass is up to 25 millimeters thick. The foils can be made to fit screens of up to 100 inches. That's virtually shop window size.
As this technology grows, I'd imagine that any window, no matter how large, could potentially become an interactive play space. My next stop was Microsoft's research and development site, also in Cambridge. They've been developing very different types of advanced touchscreen technology. This is ThinSight. It allows you to manipulate on-screen images and characters in ways we've never been able to before.
Microsoft's ThinSight uses optical technology to create a more sophisticated form of touchscreen interface. It recognizes multiple fingers, what they call multi-touch.
It does this using a grid of infrared transmitters and receivers embedded in the LCD screen. These allow ThinSight to see and track individual fingers.
And it's actually been set up so you can see what it's doing with the information. In the first box, you see the raw data from my fingers. In the second, you can see the digitized form. And in the final box, there it is distinguishing between them. And as long as I keep my fingers on the screen, it remembers which one's which.
By gathering this information, ThinSight allows you to manipulate on-screen objects in really sophisticated ways. And it felt to me a lot like shuffling objects round on a real surface. ThinSight is still in development, but in the near future it should open the door to things like touchscreen music mixing and even touchscreen multiplayer gaming. My last appointment was with a company called Splash Power, who have spent 6 years perfecting a technology that I'm sure you're going to see everywhere before long.
The curse of gadgetry is the mains adapter. Every new gadget comes with a new one. They're usually completely incompatible, and going on holiday is a nightmare because you've got to remember to pack them all. Now, imagine a better world where, instead of that pile of old adapters, you've got a universal base station. Pop any of your devices on top of it and they start charging automatically and just as quickly as if you'd plugged them into the mains.
These are induction chargers. You don't plug devices into them, they charge gadgets wirelessly.
How do they work? Well, there's a magnetic field generated by a coil of wire in the base. If you put another coil of wire into that field, then energy is transferred from one coil to another. Now, obviously your phone doesn't have a coil of wire in it right now, but if you fit one on in the form of an adapter, then the charging takes place.
Some electric toothbrushes already come supplied with primitive, very low-power induction chargers, but these are the first designed for higher-drain devices, such as mobile phones and MP3 players.
Now, in the future, the company hopes that phones will be made with tiny little coils of wire built in them so they're ready to be charged. And they hope that as well as having a base station in your home, you'll find them in your car and in public places like hotels and restaurants. When that happens, that whole great big pile of adapters really will be a thing of the past.
Welcome back. Now it's time for us to finish the last show in this series in style.
Oh, yeah. Now, you've seen the Bond movies when 007 is shooting down a ski slope, chased by baddies, and all of them are on really cool kind of ski toboggan-type devices. Well, me and Suzi have been doing just that in Tamworth at the Snow Dome.
If you're bored with sliding down a slope on a plastic tray and fancy doing it on something a bit more gadgety, then look no further. We're testing the very latest in alternative winter sports machines in a head-to-head race.
Starting at the bottom of the slope, we had to battle on foot to the top, where first up got first choice of downhill racer to, well, race downhill. Waiting at the bottom were two converted mountain bikes, which we then had to ride to the top, where a couple more downhill racers waited to take on a tricky slalom course. Right, you ready?
Yeah, of course I'm ready. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
Sure?
Absolutely, almost ready.
Well, let's go then.
All right. Mind me. We tore off up the slope, only stopping to throw a few snowballs.
Yay!
But it wasn't long before we were absolutely shattered.
Oh, I'm exhausted.
Waiting at the top for us were two of the most exciting sledges available today.
This is an inflatable sled called the Airboard. Like a bodyboard for the snow, it's made from plastic-covered textiles that you fill with air.
It's up against the Hammerhead, a combination of aerospace, snowshoe and office seating technologies. It's touted as the ultimate 21st century sledge. The first person up got to choose, and that was me. I went for the Hammerhead.
Leaving me with the Airboard. And even though Suzi made it to the top first, I just leapt on and took the lead.
Airboards have taken off massively in the States, where people can expect to get up to 80 miles an hour. Woo! And fast.
But as I cornered, I slowed right down, and Suzi used her extra manoeuvrability to scream past me. Not that her lead lasted for that long.
Whoa!
I had to bail to avoid a skier.
And I took the lead.
The Hammerhead has a patented steering system using the two small front skis, but my crash snapped one clean off, spoiling any chance of making it to the bottom.
Thank you very much.
With my broken sledge, I was trailing behind as Jason headed into the next stage.
Awesome! Okay.
This is the K-Track, a ski and caterpillar track rig that can be added to any normal mountain bike with 26-inch wheels in about 15 minutes.
The makers say that if you can ride up a hill on a bike with no snow, then with this attached, you can do it in the snow.
The gubbins on the back there makes this bicycle 25 times more efficient on this surface than an ordinary mountain bike would be. But I'm still knackered, my goodness. Oh, there goes the cameraman.
I was having problems too.
Oh, that's it. I'm snookered now. It's not gonna happen. It's got its own six-speed gearbox to replace your own standard gears, and all it takes to fit is a multi-wrench. But if you stop, you're really snookered.
Try as I might, I couldn't get going again, and Jason was increasing his lead. The way I saw it, there was a race on. I only had one option, take the escalators.
You can ride it normally on a bike.
Cheating, I'd pretty much caught up by the top.
Right, I've got up the hill with my bike, technically, and I'm not on it. What's next?
Waiting for us were the final two winter machines. This is the Ski Fox, a spring-suspended seat mounted on top of a carving ski.
The other machine for this final stage is the brand new Venom Snow Switchboard, a cross between a snowboard and a scooter.
They're both really manoeuvrable, perfect for taking on our slalom. 8 tightly spaced poles on the fastest section of the slope. We were really going to have our work cut out.
I had the advantage of not having bindings to tighten, so I just stepped onto the switchboard and I was away, with Suzi close behind.
It's very scary.
The switchboard is quite tricky to pick up, but once you get it, its hinge board and suspension help with the tight turns. Unfortunately, it wasn't enough, though.
Ski foxes like this are starting to pop up for hire at ski resorts all over Europe, and they're actually great fun, really simple to pick up and very manoeuvrable. Steering felt so intuitive, and I screamed ahead through the slalom. In fact, despite everything, I finished the race first.
Oh, yes! Oh, my bum!
I think that might be the win for me.
Yay! I got down the slalom first, so I win the last challenge of the series.
Hang on a minute. Whoa. Okay? Your thing fell off, all right? And you pushed your bike on the escalator.
I can't help it, but technology lets me down.
But that's the whole point. My technology didn't let me down.
Oh, I know. You won, really.
Yay! I won the last last challenge of the series.
But which was your favourite gadget?
I think of all of them, the K-tracks, which are, you know, I think is an extraordinary piece of technology. Look at it; it's like something from a science fiction movie.
Yeah, that was my least favourite because I couldn't do it. My favourite actually was the hammerhead toboggan, but it just, you know, it just broke so easily. Yeah.
It's a shame because if they'd only made this out of a stronger material like aluminium, you know, or carbon fibre, it would have worked so much better.
Yeah, because it looked really cool and it went really quickly, and I really loved it. And that's all we've got time for tonight and indeed for this series.
But don't worry because we're coming back next year.